மடங்கடிரொழுகும் சீராரும் வதனமென திகழ்வரத கண்டமிதில் தெக்கணமும் அதிர் சிறந்த திராவிடனல் திருநாடும் தக்க சிறு திரைமுதலும் தரித்தனரும் திலகமுமே அத்திலக வாசனை போல் அனைத்துலகும் இன்பமுற எத்திசையும் புகழ் மணக்க இருந்த பெரும் தமிழனங்கே தமிழனங்கே உன் சீரிலமை திறமையந்து செயல் மறந்து வாழ்த்ததுமே வாழ்த்ததுமே வாழ்த்ததுமே
A very good evening to all of you, and a warm welcome to this extramural lecture by the Honorable Vice President of India, Shri M. Venkaiah Naidu. Rising from humble beginnings, Shri M. Venkaiah Naidu has attained prominence in India's political spectrum as a prudent leader and charismatic speaker. Over his long and illustrious career, he has championed the cause of the common man, working diligently for the upliftment of farmers and the development of rural areas. Propelled by his passion, he served as the Minister for Rural Development in the Vajpayee government and as the Minister for Urban Development and Parliamentary Affairs in Prime Minister Modi's cabinet. He has also held the Information and Broadcasting portfolio. Today, as the Vice President of India, he brings to the table his enormous administrative and political experience. Sir, your undeterred passion for growth and development and your unfailing dedication to public service has won the hearts of many. We are deeply privileged to host you here this evening. May I request the Director of IIT Madras, Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy, to honor our guests with a shawl. I now invite Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy to deliver the welcome address.
Very good evening to all those assembled here. On behalf of the Institute, the students, the staff and faculty, I wish to extend a very, very warm welcome to His Excellency, the Vice President of India, Shri Venkaiah Naidu. It is indeed a privilege for us that he has so readily accepted the invitation sent by our students to come and address them as part of the extramural lecture series of IIT Madras, which has been going on for decades now. I also would like to extend a very warm welcome to D. Jayakumar, Honorable Minister for Fisheries, Personnel and Administrative Reforms, Government of Tamil Nadu. We are indeed privileged that he is also here with us today, along with the Vice President. Sir, you are not new to our campus. I have personally hosted you in our laboratory almost 20 years ago when you came to see the new wireless and local loop system that we had developed. I don't know if you remember, 1999 or thereabouts, 98 maybe. And once, of course, you have come several times after that in the last few years. I also had the opportunity, along with my colleagues, to make a presentation to him when he was the Minister for Housing and Urban Development in the previous government. And we went there to present the glass fiber reinforced gypsum affordable housing technology that we had developed at IIT Madras. And very quickly, he arranged for a fairly large scale. You know, we had built only one unit on the campus here, small unit. He arranged for a larger scale trial to be done in Nellur, where he hails from, and about 40 affordable houses housing in the affordable category were built there in record time. And subsequently after that, you know, we have used the technology at IIT Tirupati for the hostels and many other places. So his support and blessings for IIT Madras have been with us for many, many years, and we are indeed very privileged and delighted, I would say, that he has agreed to come and address the students here today on the topic of India 2020 to 2030, Gen Y's vision for the next decade. I think I'm sure you are, to hear what he has to say. Those of you who have heard him will know that he brings a lot of spirit and humor to his speech. So without further ado, I would like to ask him to request him to come and address the students of IIT Madras.
Tamil Nadu Amateur Tiruti Jayakumar Avargale, IIT Chennai Yukunar Professor Bhaskar Ramurthy Avargale, Professor Jayam Prasad Avargale, Sai Bharadwaj Avargale, Manavar Talaivar Yelam, Yelavarkum Vanakkam, Nan IIT Chennai Yel Unguldan Irupadil Migunda Magalchi Aregaren. My dear young friends, I feel really happy to be here in this prestigious campus of IIT Chennai. And I really feel very happy to meet you all and also to deliver the extramural address which has started some 30 years back. It's a very good practice of inviting people from different walks of life, holding different responsibilities, and then knowing their views and understanding it. That will be always useful. You are all aware India was once upon a time known as Vishwa Guru, World Knowledge Hub. Students from across the globe used to come to India, to Nalanda, then Takshashila, Pushpagiri, Vikramashila, many of these. And it was also documented by Pahiyan, Yuansong, the Chinese historians, about the knowledge, and also people used to take a knowledge pilgrimage. I coined that name, of course, knowledge pilgrimage. I have been in public life for the last 45 years. I was in the thick of politics. Now I am no more a politician. I have retired from politics, but not tired from public life. That's why I have been going around the country, meeting people, greeting people, talking with the people, spending some time with the people, and my most favorite first time is meeting the youngsters, because you are the future of the country. The future of the country has to be shaped, protected by the youngsters of the country. So that's why I said I am delighted to be with all of you today to share with you a vision for India for the coming decade, 20 to 30. I'm glad to be amidst the finest brains in our country at this eminent institution that has made an immense contribution to the country through its pioneering research and innovation. My dear young friends, the coming decade is a crucial one for India. It is in many ways your decade, the decade of the youth. Let me remind you that India's population is among the youngest in an aging world. Around 65% of the Indian population is below 35 years. Around 50% of the population is below 25 years. Today somebody has calculated it's around, average is around 27, 28 years. By 22, that will be the situation, average of 28 years. Our strategy and vision for education for the coming decade will decide on how India want to move forward in converting our demographic advantage into a rich dividend. The coming decade is also a crucial one for the world. It's a decade that will have to see a lot more acceleration on the developmental front in order to meet the ambitious sustainable development goals set by the United Nations. India has also made the achievement of SDGs a priority. We are making steady progress on several fronts. but we have had a long road ahead of us. Each one of us must decide what kind of journey we wish to undertake. We must ask ourselves what our vision for the coming decade is. In a large measure, it is your vision, the vision of the youth, the millennials, that will drive India's growth and development. India of today is a resurgent India driven by your dreams and aspirations. It is shaped by your actions and initiatives. We can collectively build an India we can be proud of, an India that is prosperous, that is inclusive, that is peaceful and harmonious, a country that would play a central leadership role in the world affairs because of its cultural capital and economic strength. We just want to pass on the knowledge and information to the people of the globe. We don't want to rule any country. If you go through the past Indian history, in spite of the fact that India was once upon a time known as Vishwa Guru, or the GDP, whatever GDP used to be called those days, around 1/6 of the world GDP used to be from India those days. But India never attacked any country in the history. Any country, any time. All other small and big countries, they came, they attacked various countries, they attacked us, they ruled us, they ruined us, they looted us, they cheated us. And while cheating, they cheated some of our minds also. That is the biggest challenge now. The colonial mindset, we are yet to overcome out of it. And also, the India's basic philosophy is guiding philosophies Vasudhaika Kutumbakam. The entire universe is one family. Share and care is the core of Indian philosophy. Share and care. Sarve Jana Sukhina Bhavantu. So that should guide us even in the future also. Why we want to become economically strong? Because we want to people to be prosperous, to be happy, to live comfortably, to live happily. Why we want this knowledge to be improved, knowledge to give it to others, to make world a peaceful planet to live, make world more cohesive. And we want to share this knowledge with others. That is the aim of India becoming prosperous, strong and stable. The path to this grand dream, however, is full of challenges. We are living in a world where there are conflicts. Conflicts are increasing. And in India also, there is still a sizable gap between urban and rural areas. I have been rural development minister. I have been urban development minister. Massive migration is taking place worldwide and also in India. Education, employment, economic upliftment, entertainment, enhanced medical facilities, they are all driving people from rural area to urban area. We must see to it that the people in the rural area also are provided the needed infrastructure and facilities so that we can reduce or stop the migration. And at the same time, we must see to it that the massive migration that is coming to cities, what is their living condition? What are the slums and suburbs are saying? How to address that challenge also? Then we must also address the issue of galloping population. Unfortunately, nobody is willing to discuss it for the fear of some reaction. Point is, first of all, you must understand the land is the same. The water availability is dwindling. The facilities, in spite of the fact that you may increase, but still, these are limited. So if you increase the population, are you going towards a life of prosperity, happiness? One. But at the same time, population will naturally grow. But it has to be planned. Planned, not that infamous family planning drive. I'm not talking about that. Every family, they should plan according to their situation, what should be the size of their family. One. Secondly, every one should think in terms of doing some service to the others, and particularly the younger generation must develop an aptitude for rural development, because there should not be lopsided development of more focus on urban areas and less focus on rural areas. I would recall the advice given by Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhiji gave two advices. One is political. I don't want to touch it about the party. Second is, he said, back to villages. See the foresight and vision of that great man. Back to villages. But unfortunately, shown our back to villages and moved towards urban areas. The problem is now. So you have to balance the development, one. Even today, agriculture is our basic culture. And agriculture today is becoming unviable. 60% of the people are depending on agriculture or allied activities. When 60% or 56%, what exactly is the percentage? If they are not taken care, and if they feel insecure, and if they feel agriculture is not viable, and if they start leaving agriculture, you can imagine what is going to happen. And a country of India's size with 130 crores. Today, fortunately, thanks to the great efforts by our scientists, agriculturists, farmers, and people like Dr. Ramesh Swaminathan, who is a living legend here in this very part of the country, we have a food security. But the food security, if the population grows, then are you assured? And then do you have protein security? Food security and then protein security also. So you cannot depend on imported food security. We are not Dubai or Singapore, where they import everything happily. You go and see there fresh fruit, fresh vegetables, everything neat and great, but limited population. But of our size, we need to develop a homegrown food security. This is one challenge. This should be the top on the agenda of all the institutions, particularly agriculture-related institutions, universities, Krishi Vijnana Kendras, ICAR, and also IITs to come with new ideas, new innovation, how to make agriculture sustainable, profitable. This is one goal we must have. There are also problems of inequalities. We are becoming prosperous. I don't use word, the rich are becoming richer, poor are becoming poorer, I don't use that phrase. Lot of poor people are getting converted to middle class, and middle class is becoming upper middle class. Upper middle class, some of them are becoming rich. But the gap remains. So how to reduce the gap? The economic inequalities. This is one challenge. The second challenge is illiteracy. Even today, after 70 to 70 plus years, we still have 20% of the people living under below poverty line. Around 20 or 18% of the people who cannot write and read, illiterate. Then we also have some gender discrimination here and there. 50% of the population are women, but still we don't take enough care about their education. Of course, things are happening positively. I am happy. As a vice president, I have been going around the universities, IITs, IIITs, IIMs, and also attending their convocations. It is heartening to note, in the convocations, when we award medals, meritorious medals or gold medals, 65% of the gold medalists are girls. This is a very positive development. It has to be encouraged further. And then there are certain areas of social discrimination. It's really a shame that so much advancement of culture, and when we talk of our great civilization, we still have certain areas where there is a social discrimination. It is also another challenge before the youngsters, and they must be the agents of change. They must be in the front to lead this movements to take care of this income inequality, illiteracy, poverty, gender discrimination and in certain areas social discrimination. It's really shameful, and we hear stories about caste fight or fight on the basis of a religion. It's a fight, different fight. They are just taking, bringing a religion for as a cover or to mobilize support, because they themselves cannot mobilize support on the basis of their other contribution. That's why I am advising people in public life, you should choose leaders. Leaders do not mean political leaders. Leader in any, you have student leaders, you have also faculty leaders, you have leaders in the administration, you have leaders in police, you have leaders in foreign. Leaders must be chosen on the basis of four C's: character, caliber, capacity, and conduct. Unfortunately, some people have developed shortcut methods, invented. Not these four C's: character, caliber, capacity, and conduct. The other four C's are caste, community, cash, and criminality. Easiest way to become leader and to mobilize support, to rouse emotions. So the youngsters, they should be in the forefront to go for the first four C's and avoid the other four C's. Then you will have a good leadership. We have, along with these challenges, you have unprecedented opportunities also. The world is open. What is happening here is known in Washington in a few minutes. What is happening here in Wasserman Pait will be known in Washington in a few minutes. And it's open. And now we are living in an era of LPG, liberalization, privatization, globalization. It throws many opportunities and also throws many challenges. We must grab these opportunities. For that, we must have skill upgradation. That's why I was suggesting to the government, and I'm happy government also center and state and different areas, institutions, schooling and skilling must go together. There is inherent talent among every section of the society. Inherent talent, not only students, not only educated people, but also among the general people, even the potterer, the goldsmith, the blacksmith. I can give you any number of examples. There is some intelligence, some knowledge. What is required is you have to recognize that knowledge, tap that knowledge, promote that knowledge, and encourage it. Look at the international arena. In the multinational companies, there's a huge list, long list of people of Indian origin heading them. What does it mean? That means this land, this air, this water, this civilization has knowledge inherent among everybody. You must recognize. And it is the duty and responsibility of the institutions to recognize such talent among the youngsters and promote and come out with best of their abilities. This is what is required. I'm happy that IITs across the country, and particularly IIT Chennai, they are doing many such innovations. Just now, Professor Bhaskaramurthy was explaining about the new technology, bricks, gypsum thing. So I told them, okay, presentation before the dignitary is fine, but practicality, demonstrate it and show it to me, and then I'll be convinced. Because then they made a presentation, then they made a demonstrative project in my area. These houses that are constructed, the buildings that are constructed are very good. Of course, unless there is a vast demand, that will not be viable again. That's another problem. So the universities must come out with more innovations. And IITs also must come out with more innovation. Science, technology, or this innovation is meant to improve the life of the common man, common people, how to make people's life more comfortable. More and more children than ever before are attending school. It's a positive thing. Access to higher education also has increased. This Skill India and Startup India initiatives are opening up new possibilities. we must now turn our attention to the quality dimension. Good quality education is a powerful determinant of the progress of any nation. There is a pressing need to improve our education system along the crucial dimensions of quality, accessibility, affordability, inclusiveness, equity and gender parity so that we do not lose the competitive edge that our demographic gives us. Inclusive growth. Everybody in the system must feel that they have some stakes in the developmental story of this country. They are part of the development. That is for the government. But also you must come out with such ideas to give strength to the ideas of the government to propagate them. You have seen the recent some of the initiatives that are taken. I remember when Prime Minister talked about opening bank accounts. There was people, some of them were skeptical. Sir, then there is no money. What is the fun of opening a bank account? Paisa hi nahi hai, toh account kholne mein matlab kya hai? That's how initially it was discussed. But you have seen yesterday, 81 or 84% of these bank janadhana, they are all active. One. And also, the idea is to bring the money into the system so that it is accountable. That's one idea. Prime Minister said this should be done. I was minister at the time. I can share with you my youngsters. I told him, being one of the seniors in the cabinet, I told him, sir, this should have done during our tenure. He said, our tenure? I said, yes. He said, no, should be done as quickly as possible. I said, if a thing which could not be done in 58 years, 60 years, if you are going to do it in 4 years, it is good. He said, no, jaldi hona chahiye. Of course, Prime Minister is Prime Minister. Everybody heard him. And I can tell you, my youngsters, within 2 years, 7.32 crore accounts have been opened. By whom? By the same bank employees. No OT, that is overtime. Everybody has done their duty. That's why this mighty work could be completed. So there is ability, and if you guide them, they will do it. That's one example. And secondly, slowly, the country has to move towards online. Everything should be online so that there is no need to stand in line. Standing in line, going and meeting people, greeting people, shaking hands, doing something in between hand, that should be totally avoided. That is one way forward and challenge new ideas for having an online system. And third, direct benefit transfer. Directly, whatever benefit you want to give to the people, it should be transferred to the people. These are all initiatives that has to be taken by the people in the government, at the center, at the state, whichever party they may belong to. But the ideas we must give. I will give you another example of how ideas help. We were discussing about urea shortage, fertilizer. So the Prime Minister one day asked his colleague, "Why is there a shortage of urea?" The minister said, "No, sir." Then why all this every year? I remember I was first time elected as MLA in 1978. 78 onwards, every year we were protesting in assembly about shortage of urea. And then, you know, there were protests, there were sometimes firing also in Gadag, in Karnataka, lack of availability of urea and all. PM said, if there is no shortage, then why this such this problem? Then he said, come out with some ideas. Then somebody has given an idea, not in the cabinet, of course. Hold on. And next time, Prime Minister came to the cabinet and said, let us start now applying neem-coated urea. We did not understand what is neem-coated, how can you apply neem to urea, what effect it's going to have. Later it was found that urea fertilizer given by the government of India is heavily subsidized for the sake of farmers. But it was not reaching directly farmers, it was going through factories because there is no measure of reaching farmers at that time. So the production, how much production this particular company is doing, that my subsidy is passed on to the company. And this urea, I am told, is also used for other chemical purposes by the factories. So that some of them were diverting. After this neem-coated urea came into practice, there is literally no urea shortage at all across the country. Same levels of production. One idea, one new innovation might have come from some young brains like you people. That has changed the situation. So like that, you need to develop a new innovation. And then digitalization is also going to help. I have been recently to some of the countries, and there in one country, very small, Estonia, I found it is the first country to become totally digital. Small country, if they can achieve it, why not we going digital? The government of India is laying optical fiber line to almost all the panchayats. I think they have done 70% of their work. They should complete it. And as I told you, if you come out with some new innovations and taking advantage of the opportunities that are being provided, startups, stand-ups, and also innovation, incubation, and this sort of ideas, that will further make our progress as in the process. The only way is to make our youngsters more skilled, not just job skills, but also life skills. Life skills. The world of work is changing very fast. New ways of working, new ways of collaborating, new ways of measuring success are emerging. And new ways of cheating also are emerging. We have seen how some people cheated our system, ran away, and now complaining from there, saying Indian jails are not that much comfortable, sir. That's why our jails are not comfortable. That's why he want to stay comfortably there. Came out with some ideas to dupe the system. So how to prevent? This is also another area where we should focus and come out with some new inventions. In this world of rapid transformation, we must be agile. We must be eager to learn. And learning, according to me, youngsters, and my dear children, is a continuous process. Everybody must go on learning. Learn before you start earn, and while you start earn also. And if some of you, after completing your IIT courses, if you want to go abroad, also go. Earlier, I used to hesitate to give such advice, but now I have no hesitation because we have enough population here. If some of you want to go, go. But follow three-line formula. Learn, earn, and return. Come back to serve your motherland and share your knowledge with others. That is the way. And the learning must be a continuous process to upgrade your skills. Learning is a must for all, including politicians, MLAs, MPs, administrators. They must also learn new methods. They must also come to know of the best practices across the globe, success stories, and then try to emulate the same. That is what is required. The Prime Minister Narendra Bhai has given a three-line advice. He said, reform, perform, and transform. Transformation of the nation by reforming the system, by every means, in every means. And there is nothing political in this. What is required is reforming the system, finding out what are the gaps, what are the shortcomings in our studies, in our research, in our administration, in our system, and coming out with solutions while knowing the best practices across the globe and coming with new ideas. And you know, I have seen youngsters, some of these conferences, and also when I visit the institutions, even the triple ITs, youngsters. Amazing. The other day, I was in Karnataka. I went to one triple IT. Amazing talent, 60, 70 small innovations by youngsters. So that talent is very much available. We have to take it out. And we have enough institutions as are now. And we have to improve the quality and also motivate our children to come out with more innovations. So as I told you, in this world of a rapid transformation, we must be agile. We must be eager to learn. We must be ready to absorb, adopt, and innovate. Absorb, adopt, and innovate. Our education must be holistic, integrating different disciplines. Our worldview must be based on India's timeless values. We have been inherited of empathy, not mere sympathy. Harmony, tolerance, non-violence, and peaceful coexistence. This should be our part of the system. We have to keep our windows and doors open. As Mahatma Gandhi has said, we should welcome fresh ideas from across the world, but we should refuse to be blown off our feet. And we have a strong and universal culture that has been nurtured over the last few millennia. We have a firm ground to stay on. My dear youngsters, I have a small advice. Every one of us should live in harmony with the nature. So love and live with the nature. Nature, culture, together for a better future. That is my advice to all the people. There is so much in the nature, but we have mishandled, we neglected, and now we are repenting. We must act fast and see rivers are drying. At the same time, floods are happening. You know what happened to Chennai city? Because we successfully blocked every water source, constructed, obstructed, restricted, destructed, and then I said, why it happened like this? So regenerate the rivers. Water is going to be a major challenge in the coming days. We are not yet ready to recognize that. So how to reduce, reuse, recycle water? How to harness nature and preserve the water? This is also another area. And then coming to the utilization of the nature availability. Sometime back, I was traveling in London. The car driver told me, sir, good morning. I said, okay, namaste. He said, sir, very sunny day. Today is sunny day, sir. I said, is it your son's birthday? He said, no, sir, sunny day. Sun is very bright. I told him, poor fellow, in India, 365 days are sunny days. But we never took advantage of sun. Now, we are harnessing sun. You have gone for solar, and we are doing wonders. Solar, the power of cost of power has come down. A new innovation, new initiative. And also, as I told you, check dams, they are getting wonderful results across the country. How to make check dams? And also rainwater harvesting. Every house, we must, our town planning system, country planning system must be such that every drop of water is conserved and preserved. That's another thing. Every building must have some solar. And then it should be green, nature friendly. Otherwise, you have the climate change, what is happening. You are seeing sudden unprecedented rains. You are seeing droughts in certain parts of the country. Same state, one area flood, other area is drought. See, these are the challenges that are coming to us. So we have to understand these challenges and come out with solutions. We should make the pursuit of excellence a daily effort in whatever you do. India as a nation, a long tradition of excellence. Excellence in literature, in art, in architecture, in administration, in education. Yesterday, I had an opportunity to visit the School of Architecture, Sculpture in Mamallapuram. beautiful youngsters are doing wonderful job. You need to really harness that knowledge which is there and then pass it on to the new generation. In every walk of life, even in literature, in dance, in music, these are all called arts, in architecture, in administration, in education, you heard about Kautilya's Ardhashastra, Chanakya. You heard about Harappa, Mohenjo-daro civilization. You heard about drainage system, underground drainage system, then itself. You know, you heard about Varahamihira. You know about Susruta. You know about Charaka. You know about Bhaskaracharya. You know the Aryabhatta. You know many, many stories. Don't be contented with knowing those stories and all. Replicate the stories and create more stories of such nature and throw light. And you become a lighthouse of knowledge to the people. That is the responsibility of the various institutions. My dear youngsters, you are the inheritors of this grand legacy. And you must take this forward. India's beloved former president, Dr. Abdul Kalam, once said, excellence is a continuous process and not an accident. Mediocrity is no longer an option here. You cannot live in isolation and have the consolation. You must open up. We are opening up. Now you have 100% FDA. You have lot of imports coming. You have to make efforts for a lot of exports also. The fundamental duties, which I believe is one of the most important components of our constitution, require citizens to strive towards excellence in all spheres of individual and collective activity so that the nation constantly rises to higher levels of endeavor and achievement. The pursuit of excellence requires discipline, commitment, equanimity, focus, courage, and constant self-evaluation and course correction. These are very important things. My dear youngster, I come from a very ordinary background. None in my family were in politics. None in my family were educated beyond FA, those days, intermediate equivalent. But I could reach this position. Go through the story of Dr. Kalam. Go through the story of Prime Minister Narendra Bhai. Go through the story of the present president. Many such examples across the country, different parties. Because India is a land, again, which provides opportunity. And if you work hard, if you are disciplined, the one thing I have learned in my life which I practice is discipline. Discipline is very much required in every discipline, in every walks of life. This is not for your director. This is not for your management. This is not for your parents. It is for you. If you are disciplined, if you are hardworking, you can excel. There are plenty of opportunities. And you have to be focused. And you must always make self-awareness. I developed a practice every day before I go to bed. What I have done today, would it have been better? I always put that question to myself and try to understand where I have gone wrong or where I have proved to be successful. That has really made me successful in my life to this extent of becoming second highest constitutional authority in India. Because you know, in India, there is a weakness for dynasty. Though in democracy, dynasty is not is nasty, but it is very tasty to many people. Unka ladka hai, unka beta hai, his son, his grandson, his daughter, this and all. But how do you come up in life? How do you want to take the shelter of somebody's listening? Or you want to come up by your own hard work? You must always remember swasakti, swavalambhana. That's very much required. For that, you have to work hard and you have to be disciplined. And as a nation, we must be disciplined. Discipline do not mean everybody is standing in attention, keeping mum and hearing what is said. No. Discipline is following order. When I talk of discipline, I remember my house also. My house means, you know, Indian vice president is not only vice president, according to the constitution, is also chairman of the upper house of parliament. Parliament, which is supreme. Parliament is our, we call our house also house of elders. Some time back, and there was some disturbance, and I started telling, some members reacted by saying, sir, we are not kids, we are not primary children. I was thinking in my heart of hearts, it would have been better if I am dealing with children, because children are more disciplined that way. The point is, they should set example. The legislature, the parliament, and the institutions, we must set example to others in public life so that they follow. Questioning, yes. Getting answer, yes. And having patience, yes. If you are patient, there won't be any need for you to become impatient again. If you become impatient, you will become impatient one day. So in life, tolerance is one important factor. Tolerance. Second is following the system. Improving the system. While improving the system, that's also another thing. The third one is everybody following their responsibilities and duties. Because duties and responsibilities, they must go hand in hand. We should not think it is the duty of the government, it is duty of this man, it is duty of that man. You also, duty and right, they are like both sides of a coin. They go together. So everyone must perform his or her duties, including leaders. So that's why I tell my people also in parliament, Babu, you want to say something, you want to protest against the government, protest. You want to talk out, talk out. You want to protest, walk out. Talk out and walk out, but don't make breakout. Otherwise, it will become all out of the system. This applies to all. This applies to all. Whatever we do, that should be within the framework of our constitutional method and constitutional system. That is the only way. Agree to disagree. Respect the mandate of the people, rule of law, and then follow and work for change. And in this beautiful country, every 5 years you get an opportunity to change whatever you want to change. Quietly, silently, without being violent. Silently you can bring in change. That's the beauty of our parliamentary democracy and our democratic system. For this utmost dedication and devotion to one's own duties and responsibilities is the highest form of patriotism. Now there's a discussion going on, what is patriotism, what is nationalism, and I am surprised. And what is nationalism and what is patriotism? Bharat Mata Ko Jai, some people shout. Okay. What does it mean? Bharat Mata Ko Jai do not mean that picture of Bharat Mata or the caricature of Bharat Mata and you stand and then say, Bharat Mata Ko Jai Ho Mane, Jai Ho to 130 crore people of the country, irrespective of caste, creed, sex, religion and region. India is one. The betterment of everybody, taking care of the last man in the line, not in this auditorium, I am talking of the society. Until they are uplifting the poorest of the poor, taking care of the last man. What Gandhiji has said, what Dr. Ambedkar has said, what Jindal Upadhyay has said, what many leaders have said, that is the need of the hour. And then taking care of the nature is also our responsibility to, so that the nature can take care of us. My dear youngsters, being students of IIT Madras, which has a reputation for excellence, each one of you must make it your personal goal to achieve excellence in whatever you do and promote excellence in the workplace you might be contributing to. As scholars, we have received intellectual nourishment. This is a place where you are getting intellectual nourishment from the supporters of this sanctuary of scientific and technological endeavor. You must also make innovation your mantra. The mantra is innovation. A number of problems that India faces today need creative, innovative, and out-of-box solutions. The need for continuous innovation is very well reflected in the government's constant efforts to create an innovation-friendly atmosphere in the country through programs like Atal Innovation Mission. There is a need to develop a culture of constant innovation in this country. Disruptive but affordable solutions in using artificial intelligence for agriculture and healthcare, drones to coordinate disaster management and relief work, water conservation, water treatment and recycling technologies are needed and must emerge from institutions like yours. Innovation is intrinsically linked to research and development activities. Indian universities need to focus more sharply on constantly enriching the research culture. We have 900 plus universities. Most of the places we have breast infrastructure. But why are we lagging behind in the ranking? Something wrong with the system or ranking? Don't find fault with the ranking system, that's for others to do. But why do we lag? This is one issue for all the people in the institutions to have self-introspection. In spite of these facilities that are being made available, what is lacking? As I told you, please focus more on agriculture. I was born in a farming household myself, and therefore it's a subject that's very close to my heart, which is because agriculture is the basic culture of this country. We have to make agriculture in our country profitable and sustainable. The rural transformation we are waiting for is slow in coming. We must accelerate it. We cannot have inclusive growth if rural areas are neglected or the rural farmers and artisans are famished. We need to come up with the realistic, cost-effective and efficient solutions. Ideas may be great, but is it cost-effective? Will it suit Indian conditions? India is very well known for resourceful, intelligent, low-cost, hyper-local innovations. Agricultural scientists and technology experts must work with the farmers to evolve new solutions to improve the farmers' quality of life. I suggest to all the institutions, wherever I'm visiting, spend time in the classroom, but also go to the field. Study the lives of the people. Understand the challenges faced by them directly. Come back and focus your attention on finding solutions. Another area that needs innovation is environmental conservation, as I was discussing with you. Our cities are slowly becoming unlivable due to congestion and pollution. Our water bodies are contaminated. Our natural reserves are steadily depleting due to thoughtless, reckless exploitation. We must apply our knowledge resources to ensure a clean India and provide affordable and clean energy, encourage responsible consumption. And production, and take concrete steps towards climate action. You need to have long-term plan, long-term vision. Unfortunately, in our country, in certain areas, politicians are coming with temporary, short-term methods, instead of coming with long-term measures to alleviate the sufferings of the people, finding solutions for the betterment of their lives. And some people are using freebies. Nothing is free, na? Everything has to be procured or produced. But people talk of free power. Power is not free. So that's why I caution them, all people. Free power means first low power, then no power. No power is free power. And there is no power, it's free only. You will not get any bill except that minimum is given. And also, people are tempted towards this. Wave this, all waving. Wave the loan. But we are yet to find out a bank which can give you a loan without asking for repayment. You need to come out with solutions. Make agriculture viable, profitable. give him remunerative prize, stop him from exploitation, come out with some ideas of marketing, value addition, food processing, come out with new ideas. Why are we not focusing enough on that? Tomatoes here in Madanapalli are produced, and you go to market. One day I went to the market to see myself. Auction was going on. I asked, what is the price today? All these tomatoes were all in baskets. They were all there. It was, I thought in Shri it was a cinema shooting. Colorful. This tomato ad. They said 10 rupees. I said, good. 10 rupees per kg is good. He said, sir, not kg, sir. 10 rupees for a basket of 10 kgs. That means 1 rupee kilo. Then traveling 120 kilometers, I went to Bengaluru. I went to my sister's house and asked her, what is the price of tomato? She said, around 6 to 8 rupees. The next day morning, I went to Delhi and asked my wife, what is the price of tomato? She said, 12 to 15 rupees. Producer is getting 1 rupee, 2 rupees, and consumer is paying 12 rupees. Potato, same thing. Onions, same thing. You know, one party lost government because of onion prices. Was there a shortage of production of onions? No. Conservation, refrigeration, storage, better market facilities. These are all lacking. And also tomato, I was mentioning tomato. Tomato you are producing. Tomato ketchup you are importing. Is it a great skill? Tomato ketchup, sauce, what do you call sauce? Is it a great thing? But we have developed that weakness again. Something foreign, something branded that tempts you. And then the same tomato which you sold for 1 rupee, 2 rupees, 3 rupees a kilo, you are purchasing sauce of that bottle in 100 rupees. Same is potato. Potato, 3 rupees, 4 rupees, 5 rupees, 6 rupees for the producer. And potato chips, 400 rupees. Simply because some brand name has been put. Can't you find out some? Then you are coming with new chips, other chips. Can't you come out with tomato chips and potato chips? This was small thing, but that will give value addition to the farmers. I'm just giving small examples. These are the areas where, and also the market must be known to the farmer, where he is producing, where the consumer, what price in Calcutta, what price here, what price is there and all. Then e-auctions, these are some of the ideas. Ideas has to be yours, and you must come with new ideas, and implementation depends on the government, at the state or at the central or at various levels. So, my dear youngsters, we must all apply our knowledge resources to ensure a clean India and provide affordable and clean energy, encourage responsible consumption and production, and take concrete steps towards climate action, and then we must go for value addition. Growth and development are important. As we move steadily by strengthening our economic fundamentals towards a higher GDP, mere economic power cannot create a world we want. We must have a focus on protecting the planet and the environment, as I just mentioned. In addition, there has to be focus on shaping a responsible citizenry and develop a deep sense of humanism in our thoughts and actions. We must focus on being better human beings. We must draw inspiration from our ancient cultural heritage that has celebrated diversity, embraced plurality, and stood for inclusivity. Share and care have been the core of Indian philosophy. Our life, we must have that attitude. Let me stress here today, the quantitative growth in terms of GDP is meaningful only if you can make every citizen a partner, a stakeholder, and a beneficiary of the development process. The government's mantra of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, or Sabka Viswas is a call, but aimed at ensuring an inclusive development. But call has to be implemented and taken care while in not only planning but also in practicing. Poverty and deprivation anywhere is a threat, an affront to prosperity everywhere. We must bridge the widening gap between the haves and have-nots, and create a nation where everyone has the opportunity to lead prosperous, peaceful, happy lives and reach their full potential. We must also learn to celebrate India's greatest asset, a tremendous diversity. tremendous diversity, unity in diversity. Alag bhasha, alag vesh, phir bhi apna ek desh. We may have different dresses, we may speak different languages. And I have an advice to all. Everyone must learn first mother tongue. Focus on mother tongue. And then try to learn as many languages possible. Innovation and research in your own thought is easy in your language first. This is the experience I have given. And then you must learn. That's why I tell all the youngsters across the country and also told the recently the policy formulators in the new education policy, we must have primary education or up to higher secondary education, we must have it in mother tongue. Because bhasha or bhavana eksa chalta hai. Mother tongue is like your eyesight. Other language is like spectacles. If you have eyesight, then you have a better sight. If you don't have sight, then wearing Ray-Ban glass also, zuban se kuch aata nahi. Even if you wear Ray-Ban glass, basic. So original ideas, inherent ideas, thoughts are there in your mother tongue. Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel in 1946, I think, when he was addressing Nagpur University, he said the children must be taught in mother tongue initially, because learning the subject is important and learning the language is more important. If you are making him to read other medium in the beginning itself, he will be making efforts and spending his energies in learning the language. First, he must learn the subject. And then learn as many languages as possible. I am not against other languages. Learn as many languages as possible, including Hindi. I am saying it in Chennai. All languages must be learned. If you want to become a national leader, acceptable to larger masses, you need to know the languages that are spoken by people. Learn Tamil, practice, profess, protect mother tongue. Feel proud that you know Tamil, you practice Tamil at home. Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, Malayali, Marathi, Assami, Punjabi, Bhojpuri, Dogri, Kashmiri, Urdu, whatever language that has come from others home, speak in that language. Call people in that language. Know if there is something happens in the midnight, what is the first language you speak? You speak your mother tongue, na? Simple. Because it's inherent, it comes out naturally. Then learn as many languages. And moreover, there is a need to learn English also. As I told you, learn Hindi, learn English, learn Chinese also now. That is becoming more important. You have such a neighbor. And then I can tell you, my youngsters, the French president comes to India. Do not speak in English. The Russian president came. Did not speak in English. The Iranian president came sometime back. I have gone through his biography and found he did PhD in English in London. I thought, okay, I can converse with him in English. He also spoke in Persian. The Chinese, of course, their leader came. I asked Sushma Swaraj, late Sushma Swaraj, kya Sushmaji? These people are not familiar with English. He said, many of them, they know English, but they don't speak in English. They feel proud to speak in their mother tongue wherever they're out of the country. This is one piece of my advice to all of you. Internationally, yes, learn English. You have to read so many scientific journals, international publications. Definitely English also helps you. But only following English from the beginning. Some people have wrong impression, what we call as a Brahma. Sir, unless you taught in English, you cannot go up. Go up. I told them, I have talked to the God. He said, there is no restriction. Everybody will come up after the expiry date. Don't worry about the language. He said, no, sir, aap mazak bana rahe. You cannot come up in life, sir. I said, what about Kalam? Dr. Kalam, what about Ramnath Kovind, present president? What about Vice President Venkaiah Naidu? I have never gone to a convent. I studied in a village school, street school, but could occupy this position. What about the Prime Minister? Prime Minister has not even seen the convent. We have not gone, but we have not seen also. But still he could become Prime Minister of this country. But that's not the case. The hard work, the discipline, the dedication, the character, the caliber, the capacity, the conduct, and the commitment, that makes you to really come up in life. Not this. But as I told you, it will be an additional advantage to learn as many languages as possible and then to communicate with others. We must keep these bonds strong so that we may preserve India's unique identity and show the world the path towards harmonious coexistence and celebration of differences. Swami Vivekananda said, I quote, "A brave, frank, clean-hearted, courageous, and aspiring youth is the only foundation on which the future nation can be built," unquote. He said, "Na, rise, awake, and stop not till you achieve the goal." My dear young friends, before I conclude, let me point out an advantage that you all have, which makes you uniquely equipped to lead India into a new era of transformation. You have grown up in the world where technologies have revolutionized the way we communicate, the way we interact with each other, and the way we respond to events. The speed and the reach have increased phenomenally. We can reach out to more people by swiftly, very swiftly. The world is therefore shrinking, bringing us closer, but some lament that we are not doing enough to give this essential human touch to our relationship. Human touch is very much required. There is also a growing tendency to use technology irresponsibly, spreading fake information and hate messages. Information, fake news, that is really hurting the world, hurting our country also. Wrong news, wrong headlines, and they make headlines, and they think that their headline is deadline to us. We should not go by the headline. We must go through the main line and pursue our own line. This should be followed by one and all. Don't be carried by these headlines. I had enough experience with the media. I was a spokesperson of the party and also NB minister. They sometimes used to say, "What is it, sir? Why? This is the headline." I said, "Ma'am, that may be your headline. This is no deadline. I will continue my line." They said, "No, sir, there's so much this thing, stories here and all." I said, "They are all stories. I have gone through the stories." And now, unfortunately, what is happening in the media nowadays, news and views are combined. News should be news. Views should be separate. They should be confined to editorial page or articles. News should be prominent in a newspaper. I'm not saying they should not carry their views. Carry it, but say, "These are my views. This is the news." So information with confirmation is more than an ammunition. Information with confirmation is more than an ammunition. How to provide information with confirmation? That's the task before the technology. If you view information with confirmation, that will really work as an ammunition of acquiring more knowledge. How to pass on that information with confirmation is another important aspect that has to be kept in mind. I hope we will be able to bring about this synthesis between a fine appreciation of India's past and a forward-looking dynamism to be global leaders. I hope you will script a growth story in the coming decade that will have the best elements from your own heritage and world's heritage. After all, that is what the ancient sages have said in the Vedas: let noble thoughts come to us from all sides. Mahatma Gandhi, I quoted, na? Let the ideas come, but I am firm on my foot. Foundations of our culture, our heritage. I am not talking of religion. I am more concerned about culture. Religion is personal. Whatever God you want to, whatever way you want to pray, pray. In this country, you have vast opportunities, any number of gods. If you want to add one more god also, no problem. Society accepts it. And some people say that, "I am also God." He himself says that, "I am God." Okay, sir, no problem. Carry on. But religion is a way of worship. Culture is a way of life. Culture, Indian civilization, It is appreciated worldwide for the reason our culture, our heritage, we live for others also. We take care of nature, we take care of even the birds, the animals, the all other creatures. We have concern for them also. That is our culture. And we don't want anybody to be starved without food. That's naturally go to villages even today. Nobody gets starved out of starvation. People, they come to his rescue and all. But as I told you, some values erosion has taken place. One is education do not carry the needed value education. I remember when I was a student, I just conclude by quoting that my experience. We used to have a NCC class, Air Wing, Navy. Second, we used to have a craft class in high school to teach us about various Indian crafts. Then thirdly, we used to have a gardening class to take care of nature. Gardening class, those days, in early days of 8th class, 9th class. And then we used to have a moral science. Now science remains, morals are being forgotten. We must bring back these values and morals into our education. That is the need of the hour. It is for the governments at various levels to apply their mind and then get these changes in the system. But as I told you, this, the younger generation of the country, you must be in the forefront. When you feel proud of your state, your other identities, you must feel proud of the country. Nation first, party or the other thing next, and self last. That is the way forward, to move forward. This is my advice to all people in the public life. And my dear youngsters, once again, I'm very happy to be addressed to you all this pleasant evening in your prestigious institution. I will hope in future also the IIT Madras will make waves in coming with new innovations, new ideas and new technologies for the betterment of mankind, for cohesive living, and for sharing and caring among the people. Thank you very much. Namaskar. Jai Hind. Nandri Vanakkam.
Thank you, sir, for your inspiring talk. I'm sure that the knowledge you have imparted and the ideas you have shared have left a lasting impact on all of us. I have with me a set of questions that we have collected from the IIT Madras fraternity, and I would now like to pose them before our speaker. Sir, my first question to you is this. A lot of young people in India today are interested in becoming entrepreneurs and creating startups. But with the dominance of big powerhouses like Amazon and Uber, do you feel there is a need for protecting startups from being overpowered by such companies? Please share your thoughts on what the government could do to facilitate this.
It's a very good question. This is a challenge before us now. You might have seen the other day, President Trump, he visited India and he was complimenting the Prime Minister. But significantly, you might have seen the first word is a great leader, great friend, but very tough negotiator. That's the word he has used, tough negotiator. He underlined it also. We want to protect our indigenous talent and knowledge and encourage our people to make in India. That's one point of discussion in the international forums. They are not that much enthused by this idea. But any nation which is forward-looking, which want to become self-reliant, must encourage. But at the same time, in the long run, you have to stand competition. There is no way, because world has opened up and we are now living in an era of competition. But to start with, the startups, initially, they have to be given some protection. How do you go about it? We have to come out with some ideas to see that we don't go out of totally WTO regime and then get ourselves isolated. At the same time, protecting this is being done. Name may be different by different countries. And I am sure the government of India also is thinking on those lines.
Thank you, sir. Sir, since the beginning of your political career, the challenge of rural development and upliftment of farmers has been close to your heart. You have played an active role in introducing the Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana that addressed the issue of rural connectivity. What is the next big challenge, in your opinion, that the Indian government faces to promote rural development?
Rural development is very vital. I can share with you, when I was made a minister, initially I was not interested in becoming a minister, I was interested in doing party work. And in the party, those days, that party to which I belong to now, I do not belong to any party, I was called as Mahamantri. In Hindi, Mahamantri means General Secretary. English General Secretary is Hindi mein Mahamantri. So Prime Minister told me you have to become Mantri because Rangaraja Kumar Mangalam from Chennai, he expired, and we need a senior person. I told Atalji in a lighter mood, sir, till today, I'm so and so. And you want to de-promote me? Prime Minister said, de-promotion can? I said, sir, till today, I am Mahamantri. From tomorrow onwards, I'm going to become only Mantri. That's where Mahamantri means. I just said it. But it was. And then he asked me, what about the portfolio? And gave some options. I have chosen rural development. Because, as I told you, 60% of the people are living in rural areas. Connectivity is the key. And the Prime Minister came out with that idea of Swarna Chaturbhuja, golden quadrilateral linking across the country, all the roads and all. We came out with this Pradhan Mantri Gramin Sadak Yojana. Because if there is no connectivity, nobody will go to village. And there was some resistance initially because they said national highway construction means you get back money, you invest. Because toll gate, BOT, all these annuities, number of schemes are there. For rural roads, who will invest money? That was the question put by Finance Minister. So Prime Minister told Venkaiah Ji, tell others also, convince the cabinet, you know, people, we discuss like this. So I tried to convince, not convince Venkaiah Ji. Prime Minister said, why in your own style, try to convince them. Then I told them, in the cabinet, I said, if there is no connectivity, nobody will go to village. No VDO, DDO, ADO, DDO, collector, doctor, actor, tractor, nothing will go to village. So connectivity is more important. That's how this Pradhan Mantri Sadak Yojana has come. And it has done a wonderful change in the lives of the rural people. Now what needs to be done is, as I told you, protecting the interest of the agriculture in a bigger manner. A lot of schemes have been initiated by the government of India, by the state government, present government, previous governments also. But you need to provide them better marketing facilities, provide them new technologies which will yield more per acre. I can share with you, the other day I was in Vietnam, sometime back, visited farms, and I was told that paddy was increased, was introduced in Vietnam by Indians. And coffee also, they were referring to Swaminathanji and all. But today, per acre production in Vietnam is exceeding us. Why? Is it because of science? Is it because of technology? All these things has to be studied. And then, as I told you, one is infrastructure, irrigation, inputs, interests. Less, but it means giving affordable credit, timely credit, constructing rural godowns, cold storage, refrigerated van system, e-market facilities, and stopping the exploitation. Focusing more on agriculture is the priority of the present government, and it should be the priority for the entire country and also to different state governments. That's one way forward. And reaching out the information to them with confirmation will empower them more. This is another way forward.
Thank you, sir. So the number of women who take active part in Indian politics is often quite small. This is reflected in the legislative composition both at the state and national level. Could we have your insights on what factors contribute to this and how this issue could be addressed?
We have to create more awareness among the people. And we must encourage girl child education. It starts with that. And then it leads to empowerment. And you must also politically empower them also by giving certain amount of reservation to start with. Because the parties, whatever may be their intentions or their pretensions or their exhaustions, they are not giving adequate representation on the plea, saying that, no, sir, it will be an uneven fight between a man and a woman. We can't afford to. Such a powerful man is standing from the constituency. We need to field a man. But if you provide certain amount of reservation, that will take care of this effect. But mere reservation alone is not going to solve the problem. In every, not only in politics, in every sphere of public activity, women should be given encouragement. And you have seen latest now, even in the army, now they are going to have women officers and all. They have given an opportunity, everybody will excel. You have seen International Monetary Fund Chief Economic Advisor, she's from south of India, Mysore, I think Geeta Gopinath. You have seen Arundhati Bhattacharya. You have seen ministers. You have seen chief ministers. You have the example of the former late chief minister of Tamil Nadu. Given an opportunity, they will excel. So you have to give an opportunity. More and more opportunity has to be given. And I, in principle, I stand for whatever is the percentage that has to be consensually agreed. Some amount of reservation has to be there in the legislature and also in various walks of life. Encouragement has to be there. Other walks of life, I don't straight away say what percentage of reservation has to be there, but there has to be.
Thank you, sir, for taking our questions.
Local bodies, 50% reservation is there. In Tamil Nadu, in different states also. So women are coming. Some people, some in North India and I go, people are saying, sir, aap hai toh achha bhashan de rahe, theek hai. But you see, sir, what is happening to women in the villages? I said, what is happening? They said, देखिए क्या हो रहा है सरपंच नहीं बैठ रहे सर कुर्सी पे सरपंच का पति आके बैठ रहे हस्बैंड ऑफ सरपंच सिटिंग इन द चेयर नॉट द द लेडी आई टोल्ड हिम इन हिज ओन लैंग्वेज आई टोल्ड हिम भाई देखो तो इनिशियली पहले मौका दे यू अपॉर्चुनिटी फॉर सम टाइम देन यू विल रियलाइज कुछ दिन तक आप इसको इन लोगों को मौका दीजिए बाद में आपको समझ में आएगा सरपंच पति का गति क्या होगा आपको समझ में आएगा ऐसा Once you give opportunities, women will assert and they prove sometimes better also.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your valuable thoughts on some of these important issues.
Anyone has instant question? Okay. Please. What is that? First study CAA. That's my advice to all of you. What is, I am not here to make any political comment. I should not do it. I don't want to do it also. But as a chairman of the Rajya Sabha, which has approved this legislation, and as a vice president of India, I advise all the people, please read the legislation and understand the intent. Understand the intent. And according to this thing is, people who are minorities in our neighboring countries, more particularly three, Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Bangladesh, we are all together, na, are we? Minorities who are persecuted, if they want to come back to India, they will be given citizenship. This has been advised by Mahatma Gandhi. This has been advised by Congress Working Committee in 1947 September. And this was being discussed and demanded by different parties from different times. That is the essence. What is the phraseology, language could have been different? Or why not you include these people, that people and all? See, India, we have different laws for asylum. Anybody coming from, some people also say, sir, what about Sri Lankan Tamils? There's another, we are discussing academically, I'm not responding on political. Any Sri Lankan Tamil, according to my knowledge, my understanding, Jay Kumar must be knowing better, they want to live in Sri Lanka. They want to live in Sri Lanka with self-respect, with equal opportunities. They don't want to leave there and then come here and then become a refugee. And if I suppose if anybody comes here, the country must open up to that idea and take care of their interest also. And anybody else, for example, Tasnima, or anybody, even a lot of examples were there, how Sushmaji has dealt with some of these helpless girls and all. Our Indian laws and governments from time to time, they are receptive to ideas. So my suggestion, advice to all is, first understand what is there in the list. What is CAA? CAA. Second, what is NPR? National Population Register. What is this other thing? All these things that are being discussed. Study. Go through the background. Come to the conclusion. And don't do anything which will hurt the interest of the country. Whatever you want to do, do it in a democratic manner, in a peaceful manner. We are a democracy. Peace is the prerequisite for progress. If you have tension, you cannot pay attention. That has to be understood by all. Okay? He is asking me what I am going to do after I retire from Vice President. That is the question, huh? He's put it in Telugu. Because I was speaking of mother tongue, he was talking in mother tongue, my mother. Good. Even in Parliament, for information, I have taken initiative that members can speak in 22 languages, any language. Any mother tongue, any MP from Tamil Nadu can stand up and speak in Tamil. Direct. That is the opportunity I have given because he will be able to articulate better. Nothing wrong, I welcome it also. The one is, of course, I am not tired. Even if I am retiring, I will not be tiring. I will be doing public service. In fact, I can share with you. In fact, I wanted to give up this post and devote my time entirely to social work. Social work. See, I had enough of it. I have been school people leader, vice leader first, and then I was college vice president, then became president. Then I was university student union chairman. I was youth wing president. I was youth wing R&A vice president. I was state general secretary. I became All India General Secretary. I became state spokesperson. I became All India spokesperson. I became state president twice. I became national president. I was rural development minister. I became urban development minister. Now I have become vice president. What else you need? So I thought after a particular age, one should give up these politics, these political positions, and then focus on service and set an example that one can serve the society without a post also. That's my aim. In fact, I never wanted to become Vice President of India, I can be frank with you. After completing a certain age, I wanted to quit politics and do social work. So I was telling Prime Minister also. Prime Minister saying, and I said, after 2019 elections, I was in politics at that time. I said, after 2019 elections, I want to give up. So he used to tell me, he's a very wise man. You tell me, Venkaiah ji, 19 ke baad na, we'll see that. And then suddenly, one day before election, they told me that all of us are of the opinion that a person from South, from agriculture background, he should become Vice President, and everybody is saying, and also the Vice President has to preside over the Rajya Sabha. So your name has been agreed upon everybody. And then finally, I have to go, I was in party, so I have to go by the party's listing. But I'll keep your idea in mind. After I give up this post, I'll try to focus on my desired ambition of following Nanaji Deshmukh, of doing service to rural people. Today, myself and Jay Kumar were in a function. Social service. That social service very dearer to my heart. Even when I am so busy in politics, I was president of the ruling party and also the vice president. Whenever I find time, I go and visit that social service activities and then enjoy and get more oxygen, more energy, and go back to do my responsibility. So I will try to do that. Okay?
Sir,
please.
Sir, I have
last
a question.
Question. Last question. Students, after complete your study, that's my advice. My advice. I was a student leader. I was telling you now. But politics and academic courses, they cannot go together. Academic excellence. You have to devote your attention on education. But at the same time, for being a student, study politics also. Understand the philosophy of different parties. Go through the life of different leaders, what they have done, what they have contributed, what they have not done, and make an assessment. And keep it for your future, and you have to make a choice after you complete your education. The reason being, you have to pay your attention towards education, which is now becoming very competitive. Secondly, you must also remember the expectations of your parents, of spending huge amount of their hard-earned money and sending you here to study and then take up the responsibility. But at the same time, youngsters, you will be still young after you complete the BTech, MTech course, you will be still young, don't worry. I became young, MLA at the age of 27 plus. So I welcome you to join politics. Stand by honesty, stand by politicians with principles, who have got conviction, who have got character, and then be consistent. Don't be tempted. Nowadays you are seeing now, people are not. You have to find out which party, which leader is as on now. Earlier there used to be in Coimbatore bus stand, arrival of bus service, what time, departure of bus service, what time, railway station and bus station, there used to be timetable indication. Now the time has come where you have to put in every town the latest position of which person, which party, latest today morning. Because people are frequently defecting. And when you talk of defection, they say, no sir, it's not defection. It's only affection. And we are doing it perfection. This is another malady that has. So be, when you join politics, be consistent. That do not mean when you have a difference of opinion. When you find your party or that party is going wrong, you have got every right to change, but you change by leaving your position. The position which you got on the label of one party, you cannot take it to other party. Though in democracy, people have got every right to change their preferences. So please welcome, once you complete, more IITians in politics will make politics more responsible and more mature also. We need more educated people, educated and enlightened people in politics. There is no problem about that. Okay.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable input.
Girl student, last. Girl. I suppose you are a boy, no? Girl student. One is, what is criminality? I was also in politics, and I understand sometimes the media reports this many number of people defying 144, taking out a procession, protesting, courting arrest, cases are registered. And they are rare in the record. Unless they are withdrawn, they will be seen as if you were facing some cases or not. That should not be taken to that level. Criminal cases involving moral turpitude, corruption, murder, rape, dacoity. These are the serious criminal cases. And such people, they should not be encouraged in politics. So political parties must evolve a discipline wherein they should not even nominate such people, number one. Even if they promote such people, people should reject them. That's why my advice was, trying to be apolitical, that's why I said it, that character, caliber, capacity and conduct. Character is a criminal character of rape and murder and dacoity. You can't expect him to be an ideal ruler or the ideal leader. So that has to be taken care by the society. People should elect and select. Select and elect leaders, one. And law, bringing a law is a good idea. This has to be discussed. But this has to be done by the parliament collectively. It's high time, because that's being discussed, and the political values are being devalued by the people. By what is a politician means like this. Only few people are that. I can tell you, few people. Even disturbance also in parliament or legislature, only few people. But that sends a message, na? Because that sort of behavior will get adverse publicity in the media. Positive is not getting attention of the media. Negative will get attention in the media. Today I saw someone saying that people should not wear black, and then someone reporting yesterday was in Pondicherry University. Then there was no demonstration in Pondicherry University, but I saw the demonstration in media. So this is the, so we should not be carried by this thing, but we should really bring out a meaningful legislation to prevent people who are facing corruption charges, or at least proven corruption charges, criminal charges like rape, dacoity, and involving moral turpitude. They are barred till they are cleared. Till they are cleared. That is an ideal situation. I welcome it.
Thank you, sir. As a mark of our gratitude, I invite the director of IIT Madras, Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy, to felicitate our guests with a memento. May I now request Shri Venkaiah Naidu to leave us a message in the EML yearbook. Organizing an event of this stature has required the unfailing support and guidance of various personalities. I take this opportunity on behalf of the extramural lectures team to express our deepest sense of gratitude to all of them. I also thank the audience for your gracious presence.
Punjab, Sindh, Gujarat, Maratha, Dravida, Utkala, Vanga, Vindhya, Himachala, Yamuna, Ganga, Uchala, Jaladita, Ranga, Tava Shubha Name Jage, Tava Shubha Ashisha Mage, Gave Tava Jaya Gata, Jana Gana Mangala Dayaka Jaya He Bharata Bhagya Vidhata Jaya He Jaya He Jaya He Jaya 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 He, Jaya, 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 He.